Hey there, physics fans. This group of videos where I talk about speculative physics is kind of fun. What should I do this week? I know. What about a theory that was crazy popular a little over a decade ago, but hasn't been discovered yet? Many scientists are still looking, but some are rethinking the whole thing. Giving you such an insider's perspective sounds like a great topic for this episode of Subatomic Stories. If you read popular science articles at the turn of the millennium, there was one proposed theory that was immensely popular in the theoretical physics community. This theory is called supersymmetry. Supersymmetry is the super in superstrings. It was supposed to solve a huge problem in Higgs theory. It was supposed to answer the dark matter problem. It was a veritable Swiss Army knife of theories. Many theorists predicted that the Large Hadron Collider in Europe would discover supersymmetry and, indeed, become a supersymmetry factory, making all sorts of new and thus far undiscovered particles. That hasn't happened. So just what is supersymmetry, why was it popular, and what's the current status? First, I have to dispel a common misconception. Supersymmetry, or SUSY for short, isn't a theory. It's a principle that a theory could have. So if it's not a theory, what is it? Well, let's start with the matter and force-carrying particles of the Standard Model. Matter particles are quarks and leptons. These are examples of a class of particles called fermions. The force-carrying photon, gluon, and WZ particles are what are called bosons. Fermions all have half-integer spin, 1/2, 3/2, and so on. Bosons all have integer spin, 0, 1, 2, etc. And the equation of the Standard Model includes both type of particles in it. Here's what that equation looks like. Now, that equation is pretty scary looking, so let me replace it with a much simpler version. This simpler version isn't correct, by the way. It just helps me illustrate the point. Say that the equation of the Standard Model is simply fermions squared plus bosons. If you decided to swap the fermions and bosons in the equation, the two equations are different. We would say that the equation is not symmetric under the swapping of fermions and bosons. So what would an equation that is symmetric to that swap look like? Well, something like fermions squared plus boson squared plus fermions plus bosons. In that equation, if you swap fermions and bosons, the equation is the same. This example equation is symmetric under the swap. An equation that is symmetric when fermions and bosons are swapped is called supersymmetric. That's all the word supersymmetric means. It means you can swap fermions and bosons and nothing changes. Of course, I showed you one example of a supersymmetric equation, but there are many. Here are a couple of other equations that are supersymmetric. Getting back to physics, a supersymmetric theory is any theory that has this property. And many theorists have devised many supersymmetric theories predicting new physics. That'll be important in a moment. There are many proposed supersymmetric theories. So why did theoretical physicists like supersymmetry so much? Well, supersymmetric theories all predict additional particles that are cousins of the known particles of the Standard Model. One of the predicted new particles is stable, electrically neutral, and massive. A particle with those properties is a perfect candidate for dark matter. But the biggest reason people like supersymmetry is that it solved a nasty problem with the theory of the Higgs boson. The theory predicted that the mass of the Higgs boson was most likely to be ginormous, a gazillion times higher than it really is. And a gazillion is a technical term here that means humongously bigger. The reason the prediction failed so badly is that the mass of the fermions and bosons have to cancel out and be nearly zero. But that isn't true of the Standard Model. On the other hand, in a supersymmetric theory, which predicts cousins of the known fermions and bosons, then the cancellation is easy, what scientists call natural. However, for this to work, the mass of the new supersymmetric cousin particles can't be too much heavier than the familiar particles. If that were true, we'd expect to have found them at the LHC, and we haven't done that. So does this mean that we've ruled out the idea of supersymmetry? No, not really. But it does mean that maybe supersymmetry isn't the solution for the unexpectedly small mass of the Higgs boson. So maybe something else solves that. Supersymmetry could exist, but only at energies much higher than we can generate at the LHC. So scientists haven't ruled out supersymmetry, but they have ruled out a subset of supersymmetric theories that could solve that Higgs thing. Actually, truth be told, totally ruling out supersymmetry might well be impossible because you can always say, well, it occurs at a little higher energy. I'm not personally a fan of the idea of Susie, and I never have been, but it's possible and we should continue to look for it. For one thing, if supersymmetry is false, then superstring theory is false. I don't believe in superstring theory either, but I like it. Kind of hope it's right. But hope isn't good enough in science, so we just have to keep peering at our data and see what story it tells us. Before I close, let me remind you that Subatomic Stories is a very high-level skim of the topics we cover. So I want to let you know about two longer videos I made on the topic. If you're interested in more information, the links are in the description below. They cover all of this in more detail. Supersymmetry is still an open question. And, speaking of questions, let's see what questions our viewers have for us this week. Question time. Let's see what you got. Anthony asks why we expect all the forces to be the same strength. Hi, Anthony. I can see why you asked that question. After all, the extra dimensions of the previous episode were invented for just that reason. However, I think the question is a bit broader than that. The question really is, why are things the way they are? It's not that gravity has to be as strong as the other forces. It's that there has to be an explanation for why it's weak. It could be that gravity is, in fact, intrinsically weaker than the other forces. But if it is, there needs to be a reason. And that's what we're really getting at. Now, there is a theoretical prejudice that the forces should have the same strength under some conditions, usually at higher energy. That's because many physicists believe that the known forces are different manifestations of a single force. This is the theory of everything I talked about in episode 30. If this unification idea is right, then gravity should be more like the other forces. But even if that's not true, we do need to understand why gravity is so weak. Jacob Kozakiewicz notes that every time that we don't know something, we hypothesize that the explanation will be made clear at higher energy or smaller size. Hi, Jacob. Yep, that's true. And it makes sense. If the answer isn't something in front of us, then the answer must be somewhere else. And somewhere else is often at higher energy. However, all we really know is that the answer is somewhere we haven't looked. The explanation doesn't have to involve higher energy. Just Paolo notes that if there are extra dimensions, then gravity shouldn't weaken as 1 over the distance between objects squared. And Travis asks why the extra dimensions couldn't be large. It may not be obvious, but these are related questions. Hi, guys. The key insight lies in relating the number of dimensions to how a force weakens with distance. They're directly connected. For instance, imagine an object emitting a force. The object emits its intrinsic force, and the influence of the force is spread out over the area through which it's passing. Mathematically, we could say that the influence, or apparent strength, equals the intrinsic strength divided by the surface through which it passes. That's key. Apparent strength equals intrinsic divided by the surface surrounding it. Put it in a one-dimensional space. The object emits a force in two directions, and the surface it passes through doesn't change with distance, so the apparent force is constant. In a two-dimensional space, the force spreads out and passes through concentric circles. The surface of the circle is the circumference, which equals 2 times pi times r. So for a circle, the apparent force drops proportionally to the distance. Now let's do three-dimensional. The force passes through spheres, which have a surface equal to 4 pi r squared. The apparent force drops as 1 over the distance squared. And it's hard to draw, but the area of the surface of a four-dimensional sphere is 2 pi squared times r cubed. Thus, in a four-dimensional space, the apparent force drops as 1 over the radius cubed. In fact, we can generalize the relationship between the strength of a force and the dimensionality of space. If the number of dimensions is n, then the apparent strength of the force drops as 1 over the radius to the n minus 1 power. Now, getting to the questions. We know that the strength of gravity drops as 1 over r squared, which means we know that we live in a three-dimensional space. The wiggle room is if there are extra dimensions, they're small. And if that's true, we'll only see deviations from the 1 over r squared behavior if we study objects small enough to fit into small dimensions. And that's why we know that gravity works in three large dimensions and maybe, just maybe, additional small dimensions. Great question. Luke Ali asks if there have been any tests of string theory or loop quantum gravity. Hi, Luke. Mostly no, but there is one test for one form of loop quantum gravity. In one form, space is quantized, which means that the speed of light depends on frequency. Many theories predict that high-frequency light should be slower, so how can we test this? We do it by looking at gamma-ray bursts, which are astronomical events that are the brightest thing since the Big Bang. They can be seen billions of light-years away. So what astronomers do is look at them in several wavelengths of light to see if the light arrives at the same time or different. And so far, it appears that the speed of light is the same for all frequencies. So that would appear to say that ideas of quantized space have been falsified and that loop quantum gravity is wrong. Actually, I've even said this myself, but I got a pointed email from Carlo Rovelli, who studies quantum gravity, and he said that not all theories of loop quantum gravity predict a variable speed of light, so we shouldn't be hasty. The bottom line is that we're thinking about ways to test superstring theory and loop quantum gravity, but we're only just beginning. Carlo has a good book on quantum gravity and aimed at the general public, if you're interested. Giovanni84 asks how we know that gravity travels at the speed of light. Hi, Giovanni. The question is both easy to answer and impressive to accomplish. On August 17, 2017, astronomers observed the collision of two neutron stars. Gravitational waves arrived, followed 1.7 seconds later by gamma rays. The collision occurred 130 million light-years away, which means that the collision occurred 130 million years ago. 130 million years is about a quadrillion seconds. The fact that gravitational waves and gamma rays arrived within 2 seconds of one another suggests that gravity and light travel at the same speeds. So it appears that when Einstein postulated that gravity travels at the speed of light, he was right. Again. Aaron Rahani asks if dark matter and dark energy can be the next epicycles. Epicycles, for those who don't recognize the reference, were invented in 200 AD by an astronomer by the name of Ptolemy. He believed that the Earth was at the center of the universe, but he knew that observations didn't support that conjecture. So he invented epicycles as an addition to his theory to make the data agree. When astronomers proved that the Earth goes around the Sun, epicycles were discarded. Hi, Aaron. So, yeah, dark matter could most certainly be an idea that will one day be discarded. The mysteries that dark matter was invented to solve might have a different explanation. We don't know. Dark energy, on the other hand, is probably real. It really does appear that the expansion of the universe is accelerating. Dark energy is merely the name we give to the cause of this acceleration. Eric Eaton notes that the weak force has limited range, while electromagnetism is infinite. Given that the two forces are combined to the electroweak force, what is the range of the electroweak force? Hi, Eric. Good question. Electroweak unification applies in a regime where the Higgs field is zero, which means at very high temperature. Since the Higgs field is zero, this means that mass doesn't exist. In a massless world, everything moves at the speed of light, and the range of forces is infinite. So that's the answer. MG notes that in episode 31, I showed a quark getting kicked out of a neutron and asks if quark confinement means that the animation I showed was wrong. Hi, MG. Actually, no. Muons do indeed knock quarks out of protons and neutrons, but the strong force is like a rubber band, weak at first, but getting stronger as it's stretched. Because of this, you can knock a quark out of a neutron, but when it gets a few femtometers away, the strong force becomes important. At a few femtometer distance, the energy of the strong force is converted into pairs of quarks and antiquarks, and that's confinement. My animation merely showed the scattering process and not the subsequent interactions via the strong force. Had I included them, the animation would have been much more complicated. Okay, so that's all the time we have for questions today. If you're enjoying the series, please like, subscribe, and share. We want everyone to be able to learn about such fascinating physics topics. You probably agree, first, because you have good taste, and second, because I hope you agree that even at home, physics is everything.